just for a few minutes from 1 Chronicles chapter 29. And guess what we're going to talk about? Yes, yes. Talk about the root of all evil. Actually, money is not the root of all evil. It's the love of money. It's the root of all evil. Money really is amoral. It can be used for good or used for bad, either way. And before you got saved, you used it for wickedness and for unrighteousness. And now that you are saved, you ought to be using it for the glory of God. You know, I've been saved a long time, but in my early teen years, I'm not proud of this, but I don't know, I shouldn't have brought it up. But, you know, we'd go out on Saturday night, and the guys would argue over who's going to buy the stuff, you know. And I'll buy, you know, that kind of stuff. Remember? Some of you remember. How many of you remember? Okay, well, a lot of sinners here tonight. But that's the way we used to do it, you see. But folks, when they get saved, many times they kind of get arthritis, you know, or something like that. Did you hear about the Baptist preacher that went deer hunting, and he was out on a stand waiting for a deer to come by, and somebody saw him and thought he was a deer and shot him 3 times through the heart and didn't hurt him, and the guy spun around and got him once in the wallet and killed him dead. So if you want to kill a Baptist, just shoot him in the wallet, because that's usually where his heart's at, right? Okay. Now tonight I want to talk to you. This is Stewardship Month. I want to talk to you about an important subject. Matter of fact, it is one of the lifelines in the work of God. I agree what I heard a great preacher friend of mine say, and if you'll pay attention to it, I think you'll agree. You cannot build, in most cases, at least we, those of us in fundamental Baptist churches, you cannot build a church on just wealthy people. Just can't do it. And the reason for it is wealthy people want to control the church. So you just can't do it. I'd like to try it, but you just can't do it. And you cannot build a church on people who are in poverty because they have nothing to give. And if you're going to have a work for God, you've got to have some folks that have money. So basically, it takes a middle-class people to get the work of God done. We've had, over the years, we've had a few wealthy people to come through our church. I said through our church. Because when they find out I'm not for sale, they don't stick around. So that's the truth. That's the truth. I'm not for sale. And I tell people, if you don't like what I preach, you just blow up and we'll sweep the pieces out. Doesn't matter. I'm not running for any office in Linwood, not running for dog catcher. I may be running from the dog catcher, but I'm not running for anything. I'm just going to preach what I think is right. And if you were a pastor, that's what I expect you to do. Matter of fact, I wouldn't be in your church if you didn't preach what you thought was right. You see? And so tonight I want to talk to you about a principle that is so obvious here this evening. And if you'll turn to 1 Chronicles chapter 29, I think there's some of the greatest truths there on simply acknowledging the ownership of all things. And you find that here in this text in 1 Chronicles 29. Furthermore, David, the king, said to all the congregation, Solomon, my son alone, whom alone God hath chosen, is yet young and tender, and the work is great, and the palace is not for man, but for the Lord God. And now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God the silver, or the gold, for things that are made of gold, and the silver of things that are made of silver, and brass for the things that are made of brass, and iron for the things that are made of iron, and wood for the things of wood, and onyx stones and stones set. And he goes on to talk about these stones. In this attempt to raise some money to build the temple, David follows some principles. And he led the way. David did not stand behind the congregation and expect them to do something that he himself was not willing to do. David led the way. And you see that in verses 1 through 5. The first thing David reminded this congregation is that the work is for God. You see it? He said that the work is great and the palace is for God. Not for man, but for God. Now, I believe that with all my heart. I believe the work that Open Door Baptist Church is doing and ought to be doing is a great work. I don't necessarily think it's great as far as numbers or outreach, but I think it's great because of whose work it is. It's God's work. And that makes it great regardless of the size of the ministry. And I believe that a small church can make a large impact if the people are dedicated and committed to doing the work of God. If you would check, by the way, if you would check at Bob Jones University, those of you who are students there, and you check at the other universities, you will find that most of the students come from the smaller churches. Most of them come from the smaller churches. They don't come from large churches. Some do. But you just check it out, and you'll find that some of the smaller churches are the ones that are producing the students. And, you heard me say that when I came to Linwood, my goal was to build the biggest church in the state of Washington. We put it on our buses, Linwood's fastest growing church. It wasn't even growing, but we had it on our buses. And so that was my goal, to build the fastest and the biggest and the best and all that kind of stuff. And that never materialized, because just about every time we'd get somebody matured, they would say, "Preacher, I'm going to go to Bible college." And some guy'd come and say, "That's why I try to keep Kelly backslidden all the time. I don't want to go anywhere, you see. And I don't want the rest of you going anywhere unless God writes it in the sky for you." But that was usually the way it would happen. You'd get somebody saved, get them on fire for God, and just like the Jacobs, they'd say, "Well, we're going to the mission field." I said, "Well, we ought to pray about that, you know." And they said, "Well, we've been praying about it for years." Now, listen. You know, it's kind of like the guy that, you know, you got mixed emotions about a situation. This fellow was really mixed up. He said, "I don't know whether to cry or laugh." And they said, "What happened?" He said, "Well, my mother-in-law ran off a cliff in my Cadillac." So he didn't really know what to do here. And so when I see, you know, people like the Jacobs and others that say, "I'm going to go to Bible college and run off," you know, I mean, I'm glad that they're moving on for God, but I'm not glad they're leaving. I never had two people in my life that were more supportive, at least I thought were more supportive of me, than the Jacobs family. So I have no joy in their leaving. But I know the work is bigger than Open Door Baptist Church. It's God's work, and it's a great work. And if they can go somewhere else and be used of God, maybe we can just kind of hold the ropes for them and help them. Amen. See? The work is great. It's not for man. It's for God. And so This is the way God works, and David led the way in giving. He said this work was for God. Notice something else, how many times he used the word "I" in the context. I've just circled a few of them, but in verse 2, "Now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God." Look at verse 3, "Moreover, because I have set my affection on the house of my God, I have of my own proper goods." Look at the next verse. "I have given to the house of my God." The next part of it, "I have prepared for the holy house." Notice he just keeps talking about what he's done. Now, you get people every once in a while who get just a little bit too spiritual and say, "Well, I don't think we ought to let anybody know what we're doing." You know, David didn't believe that. See, there's a different motive for why you tell people what you do. If your motive is to encourage other people to do something for God, then your motive is right. Why, the Apostle Paul talked about what he did, didn't he? Jesus said, "Let your light shine before men that they might see your good works and glorify God which is in heaven." So I'm not saying that if you're looking for attention, then your motive is wrong. But if you're trying to set an example for somebody else, then your motive is right. Now, when the offering plate passes you and you set like this every Sunday, you are being an example. And you know what you're doing? You're making it easy for the guy sitting next to you to set the same way. But if you folks on both sides of him would drop an offering in there every time the plate goes by, pretty soon he's going to move one way or the other. Now, David was not bashful when it came to saying, "Here's what I'm going to do." You've got it right there. I. And you know why a lot of folks don't want to talk about giving? Because they aren't giving. That's why I don't want to talk about it. You see, they're not giving. And you know what? If I looked at my giving record, I wouldn't be embarrassed for you to see it. Personally, I doubt there might be one man in this church that's given more than I have in 1994. I doubt that. I doubt if you look at the giving record, if there's anybody here that's given more than I have to this church. Right. Why do you give so much to it? Because I believe in it. I love it. Amen. I love to see people saved. I believe it's the work of God, you see. And you know, I'm not ashamed to talk about it. I know a lot of folks get embarrassed when I talk about it, but I don't get embarrassed. If a man got up here and preached on tithing, I could amen it. See? But if you're not giving and you're just playing games, you have to be quiet when a sermon like this is preached. See? And so David was a man who led the way. Now, I don't know how some of you teachers are going to be able to teach these stewardship lessons during the month of January. It's going to be very difficult for you to stand up before a class and try to get your students to give if you're not giving. I don't know what you're going to do. You know, I guess you just give through the month of January so you can feel good. You know, I don't know what you're going to do. But I don't know how a man could stand up and preach about giving if he doesn't give, or how he could teach about giving if he doesn't give. I probably would go in there and teach something else or get sick during the month of January so a substitute could take over. Amen? Why, David led the example, set the example. He said, I. It's there. The second thing about it, the next thing about it, is he put his money where his affections were. Look at verse 3. Verse 3. Moreover, because I have set my affections on the house of my God. Do you know you always put your money where your affections are? You always do. You always do. If you needed to do something tonight, you would find a way financially to do it. You would. You'd go borrow the money. You'd call a family friend. You'd go to the bank. But if you wanted to do something, you would find the way to do it. People always do. We always find a way to do that which we really want to do. And you'll notice here that his affections were on the house of God. Now, I'm not putting the emphasis on a local church, but I'll tell you what, when there's no heat in here, the heat's pretty important, isn't it? Like some of you came in last night and our teeth were chattering, right? The early part of the services warmed up about midnight. But it's important when you can't find it. It's just like Brother Dave said, you know, you don't think much about the water bill till you can't flush the toilet. Then it becomes important. And those little things that you and I take for granted and never think about when they're not available, then all of a sudden they become important. And they all cost money, don't they? Every one of them. So wherever your affections are, that's where you put your money. If your affections is at the movies, that's where you put your money. If it's at the game room at the mall, that's where you put your money. If your affections in CDs and tapes and things of that nature, that's where your money. I was in someone's house the other day, and I'll bet they had $5,000 worth of CDs. I don't have one. If I had one, I wouldn't have anything to play it on. But what does an average CD cost? Is there an average price? How much? $15. They ever cost more than that? 15 and up. Now, I'll tell you, if anybody knows, teenagers know. Folks say, oh, teenagers don't have any money. No, but they know where to get it. That's why I think every teenager ought to start tithing. I think everybody ought to start giving. I tell you what, if they start now, they won't have to be quiet like some of you when they get to be 30 and 40. They can amen my sermon. See? But some of you never started when you were young. If they start now, it'll be easy when they get older. And by the way, they will learn by the time they're older how that God really blesses. See? So we put our money where our affections. If your affections are some rock star or CD or some performer, that's where you're going to put it. If it's skiing or fishing or hiking or vacationing or whatever it is, that's where you're going to put your money. The second thing, if you'll notice in verse six, the leaders joined in the giving. Brother Kelly and I have talked about this, and what we plan to do is he and I and my wife and his wife and the deacons, I'm going to give all of them a commitment card. A commitment card. It's kind of like the thing you sign when you go to Sears. It's a commitment. If you sign it like when you got married, remember that you signed that thing called a commitment? Okay. Folks say, I don't believe in signing commitment cards for the Lord. Why not? You sign them for everything else. You believe in signing one at Sears. You believe in signing one when you got your license, you committed yourself by signing it that you'd obey the laws of Washington. Now, listen to me. Why is it all of a sudden we get so spiritual when it comes to this matter that we don't believe in signing anything? So it's just between me and God. Oh, is it? Suppose I went down and bought a new car and the guy said, sign right here. And I said, I just don't believe in signing anything. You think I'd get the car? Yeah. If you just wanted to buy anything, if you wanted to buy a television or a record player or a tape deck, anything you're going to buy, you're going to sign for. So what I'm going to ask our deacons and the staff to do is to fill out a commitment card. And on that commitment card, I'm going to ask them to put down what they're going to do for the Lord financially in this coming year. And then we're going to send out a letter to all of our members. But we're going to total the giving. I'm not going to itemize and put on there what anybody's giving. You won't know what I'm doing. That's just between me and God. And you won't know what Kelly's doing. That's just between him and God. And you won't know what the deacons are doing. That's just between them and their wives. God. Okay. But we'll take those and total them. And on that letter, it will have the total. Okay? And we'll have their name. It'll say Pastor Blue, and it'll say Kelly Backstrom, and it'll say Mrs. Blue, and then anybody else that fills out the card, it'll have their name. If their name's not there, you'll know they didn't make a commitment. Fair enough? Okay. Now, notice what it says in our text. Notice what it says in our text. In verse 6, it said, then the chiefs of the fathers and princes of the tribes of Israel and captains of thousands and hundreds with the rulers of the kings offered willingly. David took the leadership. That's what I'm going to do. That's what Brother Kelly's going to do. And then we're going to ask the deacons to do the same. Why, wouldn't you want the deacons in your church to be faithful givers? Don't you think they should? How many of you think the deacons ought to be faithful givers to your church? Amen. Okay, how many of you don't think? Sure, you think that. You think the pastor ought to give. You think that the man who draws the salary ought to give. You think that men who take the title deacon ought to give. Amen? All right, and then we're going to go to the leaders in the church, folks who have leadership of ministries, such as the leadership of the junior church and the leadership of the bus ministry and the leadership of the nurseries and so on. Wouldn't you expect leaders to give?
Yes, right.
Now, wouldn't you? Well, sure. Common sense tells you if you've got a leadership position, you ought to be taking the leadership. All right? So then giving shows our support. Giving shows your support. And if one should not lead, then he should, if he doesn't give, then he shouldn't, then he's not showing support to the ministry that he's working in. Can you imagine a worker sitting down in the nursery, griping, or any ministry? Let's just pick any other ministry. I won't pick the nursery. I'll take the bus ministry. Can you imagine a guy working in the bus ministry and saying, don't have any money for gas for the bus. And yet that rascal's not giving a penny for the work of God. See? And folks do that. We do that sometimes in various ministries. And notice this also. It was grace giving. You notice it says they offered willingly. They offered willingly. Now the third step is in verse 9. Look down at verse 9. Then the people rejoiced, for they offered willingly. So it started with King David. He said, here's what I'm going to do. I. Then it went down to the leadership. There you have it in verse 6. And the third level is the people. Would you believe that in many ministries the people are doing the giving and the leadership's not doing anything? Of course, you wouldn't expect that. You wouldn't know that. There's no way you could know it. But it is tragic that the people at the bottom, the layman, if whatever this means, the bottom of the ladder here, of this hierarchy here, if they were doing the giving and they suspected that the folks above them were giving when in fact they were not, when their very leaders were not giving. Now that kind of stuff goes on, and it's crooked. And so the leadership should give, and then the heads of ministry should give. Verse 9, then people ought to give. And you notice in verse 9 it says, for with a perfect heart they gave. Now I believe that perfect giving always ends in perfect praise. If you look at verse 10, it says, wherefore David blessed the Lord before all the congregation, and David said, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. You ought to underline that. For all that is in the heaven and the earth is thine. Do you see what admission David just made? He said that God owns everything. Everything in heaven and everything on the earth belongs to God. And most Christians haven't accepted that yet. Now, it's like Mitch was preaching last night and did such a great job, preaching about entering within the veil. Positionally, every child of God has already ascended to heaven with Jesus Christ. But I believe that in our experience, we should experience walking with God. And we should experience entering into the veil. And that is talking about a close fellowship with the Lord, to where that fellowship becomes an experience. And I'm not talking about some charismatic nonsense. I'm just talking about getting close to God and you know God's presence is there. You sense it. Theologically, I can tell you God is here. And God is everywhere. But wouldn't you like to be able to sense His presence? Okay. So in this matter of praise, it isn't hard for an individual who experiences God's blessings as a result of his giving to praise God. It wasn't hard for Dave. I thought it was very interesting. Very interesting. And you notice when he started giving, it wasn't hard for him to see God's blessing concerning the tires. Now, if you're not tuned into God and living for God and serving God, those same things may happen to you, but you'll never see them. I have meat to eat that you know not of, Jesus said. And when you and I are not tuned in, did you ever notice you get a Volkswagen, how many others are on the road? Did you ever notice when you get a bad back, how many other people have bad backs? Once you become sensitive to something, you find out dozens of people just like that. And once you and I start giving for God and trusting God and investing in the work of God, we begin to see God's blessings back to us. Or a man who's backslidden never sees it. He doesn't know he's being blessed. And God blesses him constantly. And he gripes all the way at the bank. Really? Well, just don't have enough. See? Always griping. See? And so perfect giving leads to perfect praise. Verse 12, God is the owner. You ought to underline this. Look at verse 12. If you ever underline a verse in your Bible, and here's one you should notice, you folks tonight. Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. And in thy hand is power and might, and in thy hand is to make great and to give strength unto all. You know, I was thinking last night of almost about the same verse while Brother Kelly Backstrom was preaching. And his preaching was such a blessing to me. But I've known Kelly. I knew him long before he was saved. I knew him when he was just a kid, probably before he was a teenager. And my son is married into his family. And I've known the Backstroms almost 25 years. And I know a lot about them, and they know a lot about us. If he don't tell, I won't tell. I don't know anything to tell, really. All I know is that I was listening last night to a young man who came up the hard way. He was raised in a home that many times was fragmented. It was never without love. His mother loved him, loved the whole family. But there was some, I guess many times he just kind of left to himself. Kind of grew up by himself. was a bitter young man in some ways, and dropped out of school, got saved in jail. And I just thought last night as I listened to him preach how many folks probably envied him. They have good educations, but you've been to college and you got degrees. And here's a guy up here that's a high school dropout. Not unusual to have 100 teenagers in his youth group. I mean, there are youth workers all over America that drool when they think about having 100. There are churches that don't have 100 people. Matter of fact, the average church in America only has 87 people. This guy has more in his youth group than the average church in America. Amen. You see what? You just got to get this, folks. God blesses faithfulness. God does not bless talent. Talent is a curse unless it's committed to God. God blesses faithfulness. I'll take a man who's faithful over 1,000 people with talent. Because you know what? You know another thing? A fellow that doesn't have much tries a lot harder. Guy who thinks he's got it all together is always coasting. He never prepares a sermon. He just comes in and wings it. Well, he's too smart. He's too clever. That's the way he got through high school and college. He was too smart to have to study. He didn't have to work. His mom and dad took care of him. But God promotes people. And here's, I was thinking about Brother Kelly. He's probably the envy of the youth pastors in the state of Washington. As a good youth group. God's promoted him. I haven't. God promotes him. And you take a guy like, I thought about John Perry here the other night when John was reading, standing up here reading this poetry. You talk about a guy out of place. John, where are you? Is he here? He was in the prayer room while I go praying. I don't know. Oh, there he is. He's okay, upstairs. All right. Yes, I know where he is. He's went with his children there. Anyway, I would like for you to ask him if he could ever visualize himself a year ago standing in a Baptist church reading poetry at Christmas time. Mitch, you knew him, right? All your life, you knew him. I was just in the prayer room with John Perry. You know what he prayed? He prayed, God, there's a veil over my heart that's keeping me from getting as close to you as I want to get to you. And I want you to tear it down. Now, I tell you what. God is going to honor a prayer like that. And you watch. You watch what's going to happen. God honors faithfulness. God elevates. And I'm not implying, I hope I'm not implying the wrong thing, but God reaches down and just gets a barefoot Arkansas boy with a ninth grade education who lived in packing sheds, and he said, I'm going to save that guy and put him in the ministry, and I'm going to use him to win people to Christ. God did it. I'm surprised at what God has done through me. I really am. I really am. And God reaches down, and every once in a while, an educated guy gets saved. God does that occasionally just to kind of show you that smart people will trust him too. See, occasionally a doctor will get saved or an attorney. I get a little scared. I was telling somebody this afternoon, I said, do you know that in our services now we have an attorney? He's sitting right over here this morning. Oh, yeah. We have an attorney. We have a fellow that runs a middle school, the entire thing. His wife is a teacher at Snohomish. We have two police officers here, keeps us straight. I mean, we're starting to get some, you know, God is giving us occasionally some people that have some intelligence. But he takes guys like Kelly and Pastor Blue and Brother Mitch and Brother John, and he reaches down and he says, I just want to show the rest of this crowd what I can do through a bunch of nobodies. Amen. And that's what he can do. Amen. So every once in a while, God saves somebody who's something, but not many wise and not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. Amen? Yeah, you just sit back and you can't figure it out. And I don't try to figure it out because God promotes people. He promotes them. And that's what your text says. If you look at it again carefully, look at verse 12. Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. And in thy hand is power and might, and in thy hand is to make great and to give strength to all. It's in God's hand. And you and I are just passing through this world. Look at verse 15. He recognized that we were pilgrims. For we are strangers before thee and sojourners, as were all our fathers. Our days on the earth are as a shadow, and there is none abiding. Folks, you're not going to stick around. Don't you realize that the death rate is 100%?
Right.
It's 100%. This generation is going to die. And if the Lord tarries, the next generation will come and it will die. Stop and think of all the people who've died. Everybody from Adam.
Right.
All around the world. Just die, die, die. You're just passing through. And while we're here, we are to get saved. And we're to tell people about Jesus Christ and try to glorify him by getting the gospel around the world. And basically, we don't have much else to do. Now, we can have some fun on the way, but we're not here to have fun. We're here to get the work of God done. And if you can have some fun along the way, so be it, like we had last night. I never laughed so much in my life. I'm worried about Dean Wallace. Notice his wife's even sitting way over there, away from him. That's okay. Every time he sees me, puckers up. You have to be here last night.
Amen.
You can buy the tape for $19.95. I'm not explaining anything. We're just passing through. Amen?
Amen?
Now believe that, folks. You're just passing through. You're not going to build yourself a name. You're not going to build a monument. You're not going to convert the world. You just need to live for Jesus Christ and witness and glorify God as you're passing through.
Amen.
And we brought nothing into this world, and we're taking nothing out. You never see a hearse with a U-Haul trailer hooked up to it.
Amen.
A rich man died. They said, how much did he leave? They said, he left it all. One guy said, if I can't take it, I ain't going. He went anyway. You are going. And this society, you know, if you die without a house and a bank account and everything, people say, how sad, he died and he didn't have anything. Didn't leave anything. You know, really, that's the way people talk. You're supposed to die wealthy. Really, that's the idea. I saw a bumper sticker the other day. I like some of them. I saw a bumper sticker that said, he who dies with the most toys wins. And by the way, there's a lot of theology in that. Because that's the way the world thinks. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. So we're just passing through verse 15. But verse 17 is another verse you need to look at carefully. Don't be afraid of it. Verse 17. I know also, my God, that thou what? Triest the heart. Wonder why that is in the context of giving. That whole chapter is about giving. And in his praise, he said, I know all things come from you. And it is your power to make people great and elevate them. I know that. And I know that I'm a stranger just passing through. And I know that you try the heart. I know you try the heart. You know how God tries your heart? He might give you a raise. He might. Or he might cause you to lose your job. Or he might flash a good advertisement on television. Or you might drive too slowly by a used new car lot. I don't know how God's going to do it. But he was trying the heart of Ahab the king, as we described this morning. He tries the heart. When I went to college, I always liked the professor who told us ahead of time there was going to be a test. But occasionally, we would walk into a classroom and one of our professors would say, okay, put all your books and everything under your desk. All you need is a pencil and a piece of paper. And you know you'd hear the same sigh throughout the room. Oh, no. We didn't know we were going to be tested. And if God would just tell you when you're in a crisis situation, this is only a test, you'd buck up. But the point is, you don't know. You don't know. Stewardship month is going to be a test for many of you. It really is. passing out the cards is going to be a test for some of you. It's just a test. Okay. The need for missions is going to be a test for many. The need to reach more boys and teenagers for Christ is going to be a test for some. What I'm preaching tonight is a test for some. You folks don't realize that we give an account as to how we hear as how we speak. I'll not only give account to what I say, God's people give an account to how they hear. He that hath ears to hear, what? Is that what it says? Sure. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. You have ears? Then we need to be listening. I'm going to close by turning to one more verse. Go to 1 Samuel 15, please. First Samuel chapter 15. It's amazing that when it comes to this matter, we get very stubborn. We get stubborn. And we rationalize. And we justify. I just want to leave you with a verse that you and I need to think about. Verse 23 of chapter 15, 1 Samuel. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as the sin of idolatry. How about you? Are you stubborn? Are you stubborn when it comes to this matter of giving? You say, I know what the Bible says, but I'm going to do what I want. I know what Pastor Blue says, but I'm going to do what I want. You stubborn? You know, the point is you and I are not willing to come to the place to where we say, I no longer have control of this. That's our problem. We're going to control it to the very end. And I believe in our text, we have a king who led the way by saying to his people, here's what I'm going to do. He was surrounded by a group of loyal, dedicated followers or leaders who said, we are going to do likewise. And because the leader and the leaders did what they did, the people joined in. I don't know if I would expect the people in this church to give if the leadership's not willing to give. Amen? And so you and I must set the example, and we must lead the way. And I don't know that we will do it until we come to the realization and accept the fact that God is...